It has been over 2 years now since the ominous, infamous COVID-19 virus has hit our great nation of Canada. But I never thought that a virus with a 99.7% recovery rate would have spawned such deception, lies, corruption, actions to regular hardworking Canadian citizens. Never would I thought that tyranny would hold persecution over citizens for not taking an experimental jab. This macabre behavior of hounding, pushing, prodding with threats, and shaming people who believed not to take the vaccine, who thought they had the right to bodily autonomy and don't see COVID-19 as an emergency, which was all based upon a well-educated, thoughtful introspections of the lines of evidence supporting their claim, would be subject to such isolation, defamation, degenerate behaviors, and treated like a refugee in our own country. We are still in prison, and it's been 2.5 years of not being able to leave this country. It's been the war against the family, war against true definition of freedom, a war against liberty, a war using invisible weapons hidden from an unsuspected public, bringing unexpected deaths as Canadians have been stripped of all normality and that we have been so accustomed to. An elaborate lie based upon a half-truth has plunged Canadians in a mass psychosis of fear, which drove a different way of thinking. The fear campaign has removed hope, security, trust from Canadians. And this is compounded when Canadians lose their businesses, even businesses that have survived generations, all gone. And Canadians losing their jobs after years and years of service. And with the loss of income, many Canadians then started losing their homes, their possessions, and the added stress created a division among family and friends with a serious casualty of unnecessary deaths due to the rise of addictions and suicide. These oligarchs have caused such a tear in the fabric of our lives, and more upsetting, it was done on purpose, thus humanity was self-perpetuating its own suffering by removing the age of decadence we've had over the years. COVID-19 virus does exist, but the emergency part is superfluous at best and has been part of a well-thought-out plan to dupe Canadians with lies, deception, infiltrating our governments, agencies, corporations, being pushed with large bribes, and echoed by our media lashing out with the biggest horns of fear, paralyzing Canadians who have been spoiled for so many years and thinking now that the world would end. The con was so convincing that Canadians were willing to obey an unsound medical procedure of mask wearing, 6 feet social distancing, which has no lines of evidence to support its medical hypothesis for prevention of COVID-19, using pseudoscience with a conformity bias. Plus, convincing Canadians to take the jab, and according to the vaccine companies, doesn't protect you from catching COVID-19, but just lowers your symptomology, ignoring natural immunity, and then requesting citizens that they require additional jabs of up to 2, 3, and a booster. If that is the case, it is not a vaccine according to its true definition. Additionally, the con works so well because all us Canadians have been spoiled in this country to an addiction to pleasure. So when these pleasures got removed, Canadians will do anything to regain that fix. For those who are awake and have seen through the veil of evil behavior, we have become Canadian refugees, isolated for not getting a vaccine and not wanting to wear a mask, isolated from employment, persecuted and threatened by our government in freezing bank accounts, accusing and arresting Canadians under false pretense of the law. A complete violation of our Charter of Rights, Bill of Rights, and violation of Canadian heritage, which many of us have grown accustomed to. It is unconscionable to hear politicians speak in such absolute language in their judgments of a large segment of the population who is not buying into the COVID-19 narrative. To be so arduous in thinking they can hammer down the idiotic laws while using their pseudoscience as a justification, of which other scientists are not allowed to question or discuss for that matter without the fear of losing their livelihood and shunned by their own professional class. When massive censorship occurs, it is because the lie no longer has power to rule, and therefore silencing any voice has become commonplace in our culture that was full of free speakers at one time. Thus, the known and unknown tyrants need now to be forceful by shaming and coercing individuals into taking an experimental procedure that is not medically necessary. If the pandemic had been serious and people were dropping like flies, then perhaps our reaction and behavior would have been a little different. So considering these events and the fact that many of these Canadians attending the Truckers Convoy and the Rolling Thunder Rally, including myself, we would like to state clearly for the record that we are not conspiracy theorists, as a term used so childishly as a pejorative word to shut down an argument of which they cannot explain with any strong evidence for a concrete rebuttal. We, the Canadian refugees, are not complicity theorists either. We are thoughtful, inquisitive, suspicious of, and have questions to our medical doctors, bosses, politicians, and those who claim authority over our bodies, souls, and minds. Truthfully, I will not shy away from my words, and I can cite much evidence and reasons to prove their ill behavior, and I didn't have to go far after attending the Rolling Thunder rally in Ottawa with my good friend Allison on April the 28th, 29th of 2022, who graciously accommodated me to tag along on this venture and making our voices heard, mostly to deaf ears, so we thought. But the positive aspect of this rally was the meeting and greeting of other Canadians from all walks of life, coming from all corners of Canada. Even one gentleman was from the Northwest Territories to voice his grievance. It was a time for people to see each other again after the trucker's convoy and to reconnect, retell their stories, update the status of their pains and joys. There was also some of the greatest moments from a very well-organized veterans memorial ceremony, at which you got to hear great speeches from veterans suffering from an uncaring community of political figures, unwilling to give respect for the men and women who risked their lives for this great free country. This great event in history concluded with a blessed message from the Padre, who had a passionate sermon, not even caring about mentioning the gospel, but reaffirmed who were present that we were not crazy, which empowered us to believe with no doubt of our convictions. The only bad turn side of the event was the obvious training exercise of the police using herding techniques to divide, block protesters by luring us and allowing small numbers of the Rolling Thunder rally to the streets of Ottawa, thus driving the emotional crowd to the location just so that the police can corner us with a fence wall of police with sticks in hands waiting to rumble. Of course, much like what happened at the truckers' convoy, there was illegal searching of the trucks by special police. Looking for what? A poutine bomb? Who knows? Obviously, it was all for show and nothing to do with the safety of Canadians. Also, the police making fake arrests of certain individuals and then dropping the arrested to the outskirts of town just to give the tabloid news agencies a reason to state that there were arrests. The scuffle that happened among some of the cops was not violent intentionally in any way, like what I caught on camera from the God Shot, a young woman on roller skates who had her back toward one of the cops. And the cop pushed her forward because she was rolling backward into him. So she turned around, feeling vulnerable, and pushed the cop with her right hand to get away. It looked like she was punching him, but that was not the case. But the police officer suddenly threw her to the ground as the rest of the crowd leaned in to help. Though my footage showed an obvious overreaction from the cop, the tabloid news agency still reported the incident so far from the truth it was nothing but shameful reporting. It was obvious after talking with an angry, righteous tone to the tabloid news agencies, CBC, City TV, Global, and CTV, and with a felt confidence of accusing them of lying, deceiving with omissions, and distorting perspectives by cherry-picking and jerry-handling the story to fit the narrative they needed to spew out. Hardly a response. But you should note and pay attention that all four stations would have the same verbiage, headline keywords, all taking the same leaning towards the story. This is called scripting and synchronizing the news, one of the creepier and more blatant efforts to homogenize thought and manufacture consent is to script the news at a high level, then distribute these scripts like through the Associated Press or Reuters to many different TV, radio, print, media anchors to read verbatim while they feign authenticity. Also, the use of language in the one-liner for media and politicians who have been politicizing everything, which becomes a great weapon to control the cognitive map. Especially with mainstream media powerfully debilitating language, which is shoved into every corner of our consciousness. Liberals vince conservatives. Right-wingers vince left-wingers. Good vince bad. Vaxxers and anti-vaxxers. Maskers and non-maskers. Wrong or right. Gay vince straight. Rich vince poor. Black vince white. And so on and so on and so on. Ad nauseum. Our media intentionally frames every issue in terms of fake left-right dualistic paradigm thinking that has cheapened our thoughts and causes society to a lull of lazy thinking and fallacious thinking. This constant drive of duplicity can reach a critical mass, thus neighbor fighting against neighbor, sister against brother, friends against friends, lovers against lovers, fathers against mothers, and children against children. My friend Allison and I met a couple who used to be refugees in Peru, who retold their story to us of them escaping the dictatorship of the Peruvian government and then settled in Canada, of which my new friend was speaking in tears, remembering his story of being a refugee. And then he continued expressing with great fears and knowingly that he is now a refugee again, but this time in the great country of Canada. He said 10 years ago, after immigrating to Canada, was the happiest time in their lives to be living in such a country, as he retells his present story with concern, seeing Canada following in the footsteps of his former dictators of tyranny. It simply brought tears to my eyes. And so it should too. One thing for sure, I will keep going and fighting for this great country of Canada, and I will keep fighting for the freedoms, liberties that our forefathers fought for. I will push back with artistic expressions of all sorts to wake up the silent good people of Canada who are too scared to raise the mantle of honor and truth. I leave you with this. We can no longer be complicit in our thoughts, emotions, and ideology. We require a substantial new way of thinking to combat this evil overreach of imposing foreign influence and to survive into the next century for the next generation of children to come. If we don't do something now, we will lose our beautiful history, innocence, and the greatest accomplishments of what Canada was, and the even greatest accomplishment that it can truly become. Be brave, Canada, and hold the line with your thoughts, mind, spirit, and soul. Love and peace to you all from your minstrel in arms, J.C. Moses.